الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Again, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Inshallah, I try to make that as succinct as possible. I thought perhaps that one way of interpreting the title assigned is the addressing of the negative propaganda about Islam or Islamophobia, as is normally referred to. All right. We have a brief introduction, and we'll talk a little bit about the nature and pitfalls of the propaganda, and finally, how to address in as much time as we have. We have, first of all, to realize that when we speak about Islamophobia, we're not imagining things. The spreading of the fear of Islam and Muslim is just multiplying by the hour. We see around us hate and demonization campaigns by politicians, by other people with nationalistic or racial agendas. It is not just one person's effort, writing or making speeches. There are several so-called think tanks, very, very well financed. There was a report recently by some non-Muslims, actually, it's, some civil groups about the nature of the smear campaign against Islam and Muslims. And they have already certain names that are famous in that field. They speak about the hundreds of millions of dollars budgets total, full-time staff. It is not a small undertaking that is going again. The unfortunate thing is that it is not only the so-called far right that is involved in this propaganda for obvious reasons, and we hear what's going on in the campaign now in the United States. But unfortunately, when it comes to Muslims, even the far left that's supposed to be more moderate in their views is also involved in that. Now, let me just look analytically into some of the nature or classification of propaganda in my humble little experience. First of all, there are times where a totally fabricated allegation is made, something that doesn't have any base whatsoever. Then there are certain allegations that are made based on factual information, but presented to the reader or listener or viewers in a skewed and twisted manner. I'll just give you an example of this one. When they say Muslims cannot be trusted because they have a principle or belief called tuqya, which means, so the tuqya is there, we'll talk about it, which actually they say means that the Muslims are allowed to lie to the enemies about their real intentions. So that means if any Muslims say, for example, our faith teaches us to relate to non-Muslims and so on, and relate to them and respect their faith and all of that, which can be based all on the Quran, they say, no, this is tuqya, they're lying. So whatever you say, if you say something wrong or violent, you're damned for that. If you say something correct and positive, you're damned also, but on another basis, that you're lying. So we can never trust Muslims. But obviously, the word tuqya appears in the Quran, not as a tuqya, one of the derivatives from the same root appear in the Quran. For example, in dealing with the topic of whether Muslim can have alliance with non-Muslims or not, you find some ayat says don't. In others, one particular ayah, it says, don't take the rejectors of faith as awliya. And awliya is not asdiqa, meaning allies. And then it says, illa an tattaqu minhum tuqa. Unless that alliance is for the sake of security of all, tattaqu minhum tuqa means to protect yourself, you and protect the Muslim community from the possible aggressions of others. So it's just like having a sort of peace type of agreement. So that is taken altogether in a twisted manner, a concept which is otherwise a positive and reasonable one. It's twisted to say that it is justification of lying. Sometimes there are certain things that are no more than suspicion or hearsay, and that information is presented to the Western reader as facts. It's just not, no question, it's just fact. Just like when you heard recently, you know, somebody hear about an accident that has not been investigated yet. You say, for sure it is this. And anyone who doesn't say that is mistaken and wrong. That turned to be true or not, it's just like I say, factualize assumptions. Sometimes also you find a fascinating distortion of a term, unindicted co-conspirator. This has been used quite extensively, for example, in the case of the Jerusalem Fund for Human Services. You know, these people who have never been indicted, actually, of so-called financing terrorist organizations. But even people who did not have any connection with the organization itself, they called them under the name of unindicted co-conspirator. And you know, among the organizations listed, MSA, many of the active peacemakers and people who promote peaceful relationship, like Dr. Muzammil Siddiqui, his name appears. Al-Abd al-Faqir Lillah, his name appears, his co-conspirator. And I have no idea whatsoever about any connection, except maybe I might have been a speaker in a conference like this, in which fundraising was made for Jerusalem Fund at the time when it was quite legitimate. It was certified by the American government as a non-profit organization. Those people shamelessly use a term that some lawyer wrote about that, said it is actually intended more or less to indict the legally unindicted. When you say somebody is unindicted, what does it mean? It means that there is no single shred of evidence indeed of the accusation or allegation. Or otherwise, especially in the atmosphere after 9/11 and all of that, would a person enter the US and leave and enter and leave and there is any evidence against him of, you know, any involvement in something that is illegal. So they use the term unindicted. What I was told, and among you, of course, lawyers who can explain that better than I do, actually, the unindicted people who have some suspicion is raised, whether it's justified or not, about any involvement in violent acts, is not supposed to be disclosed. It is given to the judge in a, you know, sealed envelope. But somehow, outside of the legal practice, these names are leaked and you get all kind of possible organization or persons. The idea, obviously, is a smear campaign, unindicted. This is the kind of inferences that is made The other thing, on a daily basis, there is fishing for any wrong in word or action by any of the two, actually numbers, I was getting close to 2 billion Muslims all over the world, and say, here another example. Here is another example. The idea here is to paint the whole entire Muslim community with the same brush. Muslims are doing that. So 1, 2, 5, 1,000 represent the conviction and action of 2 billion people. In fact, many of the deviations that are pointed out to are deviation from the standpoint of what I call normative Islam, the true, authentic teaching of Islam, yet it is presented as the norm, like saying Muslims, cut the heads of their victims when they kill them or something of that nature. So whoever is doing that, that's because that's a Muslim custom. This is what they have been taught. Oftentimes, self-made or self-proclaimed experts on Islam, they themselves did not read the Quran. And if they read, it might be even dependence of some translation that is full of errors, rather than the knowledge of the original source. Let me just give you a clarification of this. Usually, in biblical studies, a Jewish or Christian scholar who is worthy of writing as an authority would not just read the Bible in Arabic. Many of them would have fluency of several ancient biblical languages. They like Hebrew, sometimes Aramaic, which is a closer language, Greek, because lots of scripture was in Greek. When it comes to Islam, you find people who are writing or posing as if they are scholars of Islam. I'm referring especially within the non-Muslim community or other communities. They themselves did not read the Quran. I was surprised that recently it was reported that one of the leaders of Daesh was asked whether he read the Quran himself. He said no. Imagine presenting and defending certain theology without reading the Quran yourself. Some of the people also who remember the campaigns of burning the Quran or putting the Quran on a table and spray it with bullet and all of these provocative acts. Many of those guys actually were asked, did you read the Quran yourself? And the answer was no. Dependence on secondary sources or distorted images that were given. Oftentimes also, the Quran is being quoted. So we can say, here's your book say this. Without any due regard to two very crucial aspects in Quranic interpretation. One is the historical context, which means in what conditions or historical circumstances were these ayat from the Quran revealed. I'll give you an example in a minute. The other is textual context, which means that the Quran is not like the scripture that Jews and Christians are familiar with, namely the Bible. It is known that the Bible, for example, both the Old Testament, I know some Jews don't like Old Testament, so we respect that. They call it Hebrew scripture, whatever you call it. The Christians call it Old Testament. And the New Testament were written over hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years by dozens of authors. The Quran was entirely revealed to one man, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from A to Z in a period of the 23-year mission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the textual context here means that the Quran has an integrity of its own because of the nature of its own revelation. And since the Quran is not organized or ordered like the Bible, for example, which goes chronologically all the way from creation to revelation in sequence, dealing with sequence, the Quran is not organized like that. In fact, the first surah in the Quran was not the first one revealed. And you know, the first revealed five ayat in the Quran, according to the order of the Mus'haf, is surah number what? Al-Alaq, 96, the first five ayahs of it. I'm not delving into details now. There is good reason, in fact, behind that. Nor is the Quran organized by chapters, like textbooks. For example, the chapter on women, the chapter on war and peace, the chapter on financial dealings. The Quran is not like that, because it's not a textbook. But once you finished one chapter, you move to the next one. I'll just give you a slight illustration of this. When you look at the first surah in the Quran, it is essentially, that's why it is short, even though there, most of the surahs after that go by length, roughly, but not fully. That the first surah in the Quran is like a dua for anyone who wants to study that book and open his or her mind and heart. You make dua to Allah if you're sincere, okay? You make praises of Allah. And then how does the surah end? Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Oh Allah, guide us the straight path, the path of those on whom you bestowed your mercy, not those who earned your wrath, and so on. You notice that when you move to Surah Al-Baqarah, which is disproportionately much longer than Al-Fatiha, after the introduction of the Surah, Alif Lam Mim, which in the best interpretation is that this Quran addressed you to you Arab who are priding yourself on the mastery of the Arabic language, and this Quran is in your own language, just like Alif and Lam and Mim, but you could not imitate it and so on. Anyway, so after that introduction, basically, what does it say? ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. Remember at the end of the previous surah, you were praying for what? Guidance to the straight path. So the answer comes in the second surah. This is the book. There is no doubt about it. If you're looking for guidance, you find it here. And actually, there is a study that shows not only the emphasis and the changing nature of each surah following the other, but even the ending of one surah and the beginning of the other surah, and also the beginning of the surah and end of the same surah. This is a whole field that a lot of people really have no idea even that it exists. For someone to come and pick a copy of the translation of the Quran and say, here it's, right here it says this, it says that, without having a thorough understanding of the Quran in its original language to distinguish between correct or incorrect translations. Now I'd like to give you an example which is very often quoted. Okay. All right, I just got it from my memory. Remember, what is the most controversial ayah that has been quoted by Islamophobes to prove that the Quran is the source of violence? Anyone remember? Yeah, Surah 9, Tawbah, the fifth ayah. And sometimes they don't even quote the whole ayah. Sometimes it's quoted. فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْثُ وَجَدْتُمُوهُمْ وَخُذُوهُمْ وَاحْصُرُوهُمْ وَاقْعُدُوا لَهُمْ كُلَّ مَرْصَدٍ. Yes, I can prove it to you. Give me a copy of the Quran. It says that. Kill. And notice here for the translation, I'll come to the translation. They translate mushrikeen wrongly also. Kill the non-believers. And I've seen one writer, Islamophobic writer, even putting between brackets, including Jews and Christians, between brackets. Wherever you find them, seize them and stay in ambush for them in every place. I say, what could be more violent teaching than that? That a person, by being an unbeliever, deserves to be killed. Okay. Let me take the historical context that would change the entire picture. When was that revealed? In what context? You have to go back to history. But these people would care only about history when it served their purposes. But history of revelation, that's not important. It sounds good like that. It's so violent. It's good. Leave it as it is. You know, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to Medina, they stayed there for a number of years, and then at one point of time they wanted to go for Umrah. And they came in the, you know, the attire of Umrah, with every sign that they're trying to get back to Mecca peacefully, we're not coming to fight. One of those signs, as you know, that they used to mark the sacrifice animal, sacrificial animals, they have certain marks on them. They didn't have any arms except, of course, the small things that you need for defense, self-defense, you know, traveling in the desert or facing any danger. But other than that, it's not the shields and arrows and spears and that you use for war. They were intercepted, just a reminder, on the precincts of Mecca by the idolatrous Arabs. They were well armed and many were on horses. They almost like told them, you can't go. Even though the sacred house, as you know, of course, was an ancient sacred, not only to Quraysh in Mecca, but all Arabs even used to have some affinity with it. Muslims were very irritated and were willing to fight for the right. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he swore that if we conclude a peace agreement with them and maintain the kinship relationship, I would respond. Okay? Now negotiation started. Arrogance on the part of the Meccans was amazing. It was not like a treaty where you get give and take. It was always take, almost take. Example, they demanded that if any of the Muslims who went to Medina apostates and he wants to go back to Mecca, he should go freely, should not prevent them. But the reverse is not true. If one of us, idolatrous Arabs, come to Medina to embrace Islam, you've got to return them. Okay? Secondly, after all your trip, you can't go this year, but we can allow you next year. Imagine treading the desert for a couple of weeks in the heat and suffering. But not this year. Just arbitrary arrogance on their part. All of that was given by the Prophet ﷺ, guided again by Allah. Some of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ were very, very irritated, including Umar radiallahu an, when he said, Ya Rasulallah, O Prophet of Allah, aren't we on the true path? They said, yes. He said, yes. He said, فَلِمَا نَرْضَ الدَّنِيَّةَ فِي دِينَنَا. How could we accept this humiliation in our religion? And the Prophet, and that proves, again, it was not just his own thought. He said, Allah guided me, and he will not let us down. You know what? The only item that the Prophet insisted on in return for all of these concessions, that there will be a period of peace between us for a period of, anybody remember? 10 years. That's what he was putting his mind on. Within a period of nearly, you know, 18 months or so, more people embraced Islam not ratio, numerically,
than those accepted Islam in the previous 16 or more years. You know why? Because when there is a state of conflict, everybody would be hunkering down. The idea of we versus they or them is there. But once there was a period of peace, people can intermingle, no attacks on caravans, people buy and sell, talk to one another. How many of you have seen, by show of hands, al-Risala, you know, this the message about the life of the Prophet? Remember when Khalid, who was still an enemy of the Prophet and Islam and very proud man, come with some other people, listen to Bilal and other Muslims. It depicts a reality. It doesn't have to have been Bilal in particular. Anyway, teaching others about the ethics of Islam, about the peace of Islam. They listen, but he's still so proud, and he goes. Many of those people who were, you know, staunch enemies of the Prophet, when the atmosphere was of listening, their hearts were touched. And you know, ultimately Khalid himself, who fought against the Prophet, especially in the Battle of Uhud, and was one major reason for the setback for Muslims, ultimately accepted Islam. Do you realize that historically, and I'm not a historian, but you read history, from the time of the Treaty of Hudaybiyah until this 21st century, Islam spread more during the peace, the periods of peace, than war. And that was the divine wisdom to guide the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to insist on that peace treaty. Even you hear about the cartoons, bad as it may be, and bad the reaction of some Muslims in a strong emotional or violent way it might have been, still a lot of people were wondering or curious, what is that religion that says to kill an artist or a writer or painter? And I heard the term, copies of the translation of the Quran in the Western world, especially some countries, were flying off the shelf. More recently, one fellow from the Netherlands, he was a staunch attacker of Islam, and he ended up becoming an enthusiastic Muslim. As the Quran says, وَلَكِنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَعْلَمُ, because they don't know, they don't understand, all blindly engulfed in that. In any case, I'm just clarified the setting, the historical setting. After approximately a year and a half of that treaty that, you know, witnessed a huge acceptance of Islam from former adversaries, the other side, not the Prophet side, sneaked at night and called bloodedly, murdered a number of people, the allies of the Prophet, because it was an alliance, the Prophet and his allies, and the Meccan and their allies. What do you call that action in modern term? International law. Attacking people with whom you signed a peace treaty. And the other side, the Prophet side, never violated. He was extremely meticulous in observing any treaty that he signed, even if it's to the advantages of Muslims. You call it war crimes. How do you handle war criminals? Kids' gloves? No. So historically speaking then, you're dealing not with everybody who's not a Muslim, let alone even idolatrous Arab. You're dealing with war criminals, not with everybody else. So to generalize it and say Islam teaches that you kill any non-Muslim that you find, it's an utter distortion of the fact. But now let us take the textual context, meaning this ayah did not come from nowhere to be cherry-picked to prove that Islam is violent and the source of violence is even the Quran itself. If you read carefully, even the 14 ayahs, not ayah 5, يعني begin read from chapter 9 verse 1 to 14, not just to go straight to verse 5. In the beginning it speaks about the earlier verses. فإذا انسلخ الأشهر الحرم, even just before it speaks about killing, فإذا انسلخ الأشهر الحرم, meaning that when the sacred month had elapsed. The sacred month was an Arabian practice which Islam accepted because it's good, because it guarantees no war for one third of the time. Were 4 months, three consecutive ones and a separate one. During these 4 months, it was the commitment among the Arabs that there would be no fighting. To the point that they say, if you meet the one who killed your father, you don't fight. That's total moratorium. Is that bad? One third of the year, moratorium on fighting. Why didn't they mention that even beginning of the ayah? Why do you think some of the Islamophobes ignore it? Because they're addressing people who mostly have no familiarity or even access to the Quran in spite of all the internet. They're not familiar. And they think that those people are authorities. But because if anyone who doesn't know anything about Islam even, and you say, when the sacred month ended, then kill. What is the logical question that the person will be asking? What are these sacred months? And once he begins to question, and many people, by the way, are not blindly fanatical. Many people are sincere. So he asks to know. And once he or she discovers that this is related to sacred months, and you start digging and getting the information that this was because of the breaking of the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. A second element of the context that is ignored in some way or the other. Is this the only ayah? Well, let's stick even to it before we move even to outside of that section. If you read the ayah carefully, you find proof indeed that it is with respect to those who betrayed their treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his allies. Why? You find in one ayah in the 14th, verse 14. وَهُمْ بَدَأُوكُمْ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةً. And they are the ones, meaning the pagan Arabs, idolatrous, are the ones who started, meaning fighting against you in the first place. It also say that they don't observe any relationship or kins or covenant. لَا يَرْقُبُونَ فِي مُؤْمِنٍ إِلَّا ولا ذمة. No covenant. What is that covenant? The Treaty of Hudaybiyah. Obviously. Many people did not notice the dishonesty even of using the term non-believers, or including Jews and Christians. Anyone who's familiar with the Quran, there are three different terms. One is kafir, and I'll get to that point again. By way of terminology, kafir. And kafir comes from cover up or conceal. You were just beginning. Okay, how much time can you give? Finished?
That's what it says on the card. So.
It started to get heat. Can I just finish that point?
Okay, inshallah.
Yeah? Finish. I'll give you a red check for the rest. Okay. It excludes, the word non-kafir or non-Muslim includes everyone. But in Surah Al-Bayyinah, which is Surah number 98, it makes a distinction that among those who rejected Islam, which of course is their full right, لَمْ يَكُنِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ. There are two categories of people. People of the book, meaning Jews and Christians. Nowhere in the Quran did I find these people refer to as mushrikeen, as a title, Ahli al-Kitab. Wal mushrikeen, and the ayah makes it clear that people of the book are not the mushrikeen, even if they commit shirk, but they never called mushrikeen. And the ayah says, faqtulu, it didn't say people of the book, it didn't say faqtulu every non-believer, but al-mushrikeen. But even among mushrikeen, you find that excluded for that, from that in more than one ayah in the beginning are those who did not break their covenant. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ عَاهَدْتُمْ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ عَاهَدْتُمْ عِنْدَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. It's so obvious, with the least of fairness, that this is not to be applicable to this. But if you take the broad context of the Quran, and somebody tell you that your religion teaches you to kill the non-believers, there is no single ayah in the Quran that I know of that ever give you the permission to kill someone on account of his religion. You're not allowed. The contrary is true. In Surah 60, Mumtahana, in ayah 8, it makes it clear. And let's give translation, لا ينهاكم الله for the time. Allah does not forbid you, O Muslims, with respect to those who did not fight you because of your religion or drive you out of your homes, that you should deal with them in kindness and justice. And obviously, severing heads has nothing to do neither with justice or kindness, provided they're not fighting you. In Surah Al-Baqarah, from ayah 190 on, it makes it clear that you fight only those who are fighting against you. وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا. You don't exceed the limit. You don't. In other words, this is just a sample, and I could go on and on in more depth, even to show fallacies in the most abused ayah in the Quran in the anti-Muslim here. With this in mind, I just want to come to some conclusion anyway, very quickly, and leave a lot of very useful things. But oftentimes they equate opinions of scholars in a given period of time of juridical history of Islam as if it's frozen in history. It might have been, some ideas have been valid for their times, but not. Finally, to address negative propaganda, one, we have to have a commitment to be involved, not to watch, like they say, lit a candle instead of cursing darkness. Second, let's be honest with ourselves. We Muslims sometimes are unable to give a non-emotional, scholarly, well-founded answer. We keep going in circles because we think that because we were born in some Muslim countries, we know everything. So we need to educate ourselves in even this, some of these difficult and controversial issues so that we give truthful but correct answer also. Okay? We have to study also the etiquette of dealing with people. The Prophet ﷺ faced many insulting moments, many attacks on his person, many attacks on his teaching, but he never lost his mind or started shouting. Always, تعالوا إلى كلمة سواء بيننا وبينك. Let's come to a common terms between you and us. And focus, not unlike some young youth. I was one, but to some lesser degree in their olden times, are interested in debate and this. No, I think the name of the game now, really, and that's consistent with the Quran, is number one, to find the common grounds, and you'll find many. Two, to understand respectfully the differences. Three, cooperate in the area there is common ground, leave theology aside, protection of involvement, helping the poor. This is the practical dialogue in the field rather than in books or lecture halls. So these are some of the guidance, and if you study more how the Prophet ﷺ did his da'wah, I think we can learn a little bit more. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And my apology if I exceeded that. In fact, to tell you the truth, I have been almost traveling constantly within a span of 31 days, 23 days in travel. How much time to prepare for it? So forgive me if my presentation was a bit halting and my voice is gone. You know the reason. But may Allah accept from all of us whatever little we can. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum.